this is Dan Welch. He is a really good friend of Rob and works with Rob Shreves. And I had the opportunity to meet him at our cornhole tournament, and he did a wonderful job. So we asked him if he would come in and sing for us, and we just want to thank him for doing that today. And you're going to hear a lot more of him. It looks like most of the people here had decided to take the day off, but that's okay. We're still here, and we're prepared, and we're ready to hear what God has to say through music, through our fellowship, and hopefully through the Word of God as well. And if you're here and we don't have your information, or if you've changed, if you would, just take one of those green connection cards and get us up to date. We like to keep you informed of what's going on here. We got some really exciting stuff that we'll go into in a little bit later. But this morning, I just want to know, I'm going to try and embarrass you, but if you're a grandparent, will you raise your hand? That's about most of the people in here. So if you're a grandparent, we want to take this today to welcome you and tell you Happy Grandparents Day. Grandparents Day has been a national event. It's a secular holiday. It was signed into law by Jimmy Carter back in 1978, I think it was. And some of us are actually old enough to remember who Jimmy Carter was and what he did in office. But next week, we just... before I forget, one of the things I like, the official flower for Grandparents Day, National Grandparents Day, is to forget me not. And they say the reason they chose that was not just because of the name, but it's a perennial flower, which means it comes back every year. It's a real easy, unfussy flower is how they described it, and one that just produces beautiful foliage year after year. And I thought about it, and I said, you know, that really described my grandparents, and I hope it does yours as well. I also want to remind you, next week is National Back to Church Sunday, and we have coupled along with that with our one-year anniversary, and we're going to have some barbecue, we're going to have some fellowship, we'll probably have some games out there for the kids, so we're just asking everybody to invite everybody you can. In fact, we challenged you last week. If you didn't see last week's message, we would encourage you to go online and watch it at www.theodysseychurch.com. Not because the speaker was so great, but because the message was so important. We talked about God's lost children, about those that aren't lost spatially. God knows where we're at, but those that are lost relationally. And the challenge we put out was, if you would, to invite 10 of your friends, or invite 5 specifically unchurched, or people that aren't going to church right now, and then bring them to church with you next week. So we're challenging everybody to do that. We sort of try to make it easy for you. You'll hear about that just in a little bit, in a few more minutes. But before I ask Dan to come back up here and bless with the music, I sort of want to tell you something that happened to me at the vet's office the other day. I got this little 11-year-old Pomeranian named Camille, and I don't know about any of you, but sometimes I spoil my dog more than I spoil my kids. And my kids ask me why. I said, well, if you treated me as good as the dog did, I'd probably treat you as good as I treat the dog, but I don't know. So... I'm at the vet's office, I get there, and there's like nobody there but me. So it's me and Camille, and I'm just like, I'm starting to feel a little lonely, I have to admit. So me and Camille sit there just a few minutes, and suddenly this little old lady walks in, and she's got a cat in a cage. And she comes up, and she sits down right beside me, and you know, after the normal pleasantry, you know, how you doing, how's the weather, I guess, she looks at me and goes, so, you like dog like cats? I get excited, I say, yeah, Camille loves cats. She goes, oh, really, your dog loves cats? I said, yes, she loves cats. She thinks they taste like chicken.
Oh,
and all of a sudden, I'm alone again. I don't know. Anyway, today we are going to be talking about this wild beast, this untamable beast, this beast that hides behind these enamel bars. And if you keep it behind the enamel bars, everything is great. But if you ever let it loose, it can bring terrible danger. It's full of a deadly poison. If you don't know what that is yet, we're going to come up and we're going to listen to Dan, and then we'll go into our tithes and offerings, and then we'll hear the message. But please welcome Dan Welch to come back up and let him minister to us in music. God bless. Thank you, brother.
get too long-winded, Pastor. You just kind of wave at me.
I don't even have a clock in front of me, so you're good.
Long-winded. I was going to say that. Thank you, John.
Depends on whether you want to get home by lunch or something. In just a few minutes, we're going to go to our regular tithes and offerings. But I do want to thank you, Dan, wherever you are. I really, truly appreciate it. I mean, talk about the lost, and really, that was our message last week. It's part of what we're talking about today, because that was always God's heart. That was always God's heart. He was always looking for those that were outside of a relationship with Him, not those that were inside. God's heart was He sent His Son to seek and save those that were lost. And sometimes as a church, we forget that, and we start to become very inwardly focused and try to be focused on ourselves and what we're doing here. But God says, listen, it's my lost sheep that I need you to come. There'll be more rejoicing in heaven over one found sheep than there will over the 99 that are already found. So just praise God. And you know, I was sitting there as I was thinking, when I was in business, I had a guy at work that was not saved and really was rejecting Christ. And every month we were in business, we put a different cross up on the wall. It was a good idea in the beginning, but when we had about 150 of them up there, we're starting to find out of space. But I bought one in specific that said, when I was on the cross, you were on my mind, with Jesus hanging there, and I hung it at that one directly over his death. So every time he had to look at that, and we forget that that's a very personal statement. Sometimes we sort of say Jesus died for everyone, and we put it all out there, but the fact of the matter is, if just one person was saved for our salvation, he would have died for you. It was that you were on his mind when he was on the cross. And the other thing, you know, we are in his presence. We sometimes think about this faraway God that's up in heaven looking down. But the matter of fact is, he is right here with us today. He is a very close, a very relational God. So we just truly appreciate your songs worked out perfect. God always is in control. And we sometimes have a tendency to forget that. Last week, as we talked about the loss, what we said is, you know, we want everybody to intercede or to pray. To take these salvation cards and pick out four or five people and just begin to pray that God would open their hearts to invitation to church. And as you can see, these are the people that I'm praying for. I'm an overachiever, so I've got about 20 of them out there. And I think about this. If each one of us were to take five people and invite them to church, take 10 of those postcards, and maybe if you see somebody out the store, just ask them. If each one of them just asked 10 people to church, between last week and this week, that's about 400 people. If each one of us did it, they would get invited to church next week. And we should be really loving our lost children, our lost friends, our lost acquaintances, those that are in our family, and just see if we can get them here to church so those that are lost can be found. So it all starts with intercession. It all starts with prayer. And we need to invest in them. I mean, God in the flesh, God in the body, when Jesus came to earth, he was very relational. Very relational. That takes time. That takes effort. We need to invest in him. You know, sometimes when we talk about investing in church, people think we're investing financially, which we are. And I'm so appreciative for all of you that invest into what God's vision is for our church. We couldn't do what we do without you. And we pour everything you give us right back into the community, the best of our ability. We truly, truly appreciate that. But there's also a time investment that we need. But not only do we need to intercede with our friends and invest in our friends and invest in the lost and our loved ones, we need to actually do the hardest part. And really the hardest part sometimes is simply inviting them to church. So what we've done is we've tried to make it as comfortable and as easy as we can, because we're going to have some free food, we're going to have some festivities, and who doesn't like free food and festivities? So we invite them to come for the food, tell them you'll pick them up, do whatever you got to do to get them here next week. I think it'll be worth the investment, it'll be worth their time. Just intercede for them, invest in them, and invite them to come next week, and maybe some of those that are lost will be found. Okay, we'll get ready to go to our tithes and offering, and as we do, I'm going to pray and then enjoy this short video, and I will get you out of here before supper time. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, and we praise you so much for the people that are here today. And Lord, for whatever reasons, those that are usually here that aren't here today, Lord, we just ask that everything's okay, that they're safe. Father, we just pray in your holy name today that you take what is given to us in our tithes and offerings, Father, and that you use it and multiply it and give us the wisdom to be good stewards. Father, our church has this tremendous love for others, and as we outpour to others, Lord, we just let them see Jesus through us. Thank you for Dan this morning, and just continue to bless his music ministry. And Lord, as we go out through our day, Father, let your light shine through our cracks. We ask all of this in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen.
You are invited to join us for Back to Church Sunday. You may have some memories or thoughts of what church is really all about. Is it a place to get married? A place you go when someone dies? A big potluck? Sometimes with that mystery dish. Bible stories on a flannel board? A place to sing hymns? It can be some of those things, but it is really learning to love God and to love others. Seeing our relationships with family and friends grow stronger, serving our community, and a place to find hope in a world facing trouble. Also, that we can share the incredible good news of Jesus with others who need this good news just like we do. We believe Jesus died on the cross and rose again to save us all, bringing us new life, healing, and peace. If it's been a while since you've been to church, or it's your very first time, or you're here every Sunday, no matter where you come from or where you've been, you are welcome at our church.
All right. Well, praise be to God. I do want to take time once again to welcome everybody here, and just thank you so much for what you're doing. I'm really excited about what's coming up over the next couple of weeks. I'm excited about today's message. I'm also excited to be able to share next week what God's done through us and in us in the last 12 months. And, you know, again, you all know me. My favorite two four-letter words are free and food, and you put them together, and I'm right there. So the following week after that, on the 27th, we've got a brand-new series starting called Love Is. So there's a lot of stuff going on. We may be a small church, but we have a great big vision because we serve a great big God. And that's just some of the reasons. Over the next couple of weeks, you're going to see we introduce some new series, but we're also going to introduce some new ways we're going to outreach to the community. And one of those is coming up is the coat drive. So if you are not wearing it, please share it. You know, bring in your excess coats, your extra coats, things that you haven't worn in 2 or 3 years. And on October 3rd, from 10 a.m. to about 4 p.m., we're going to open this place up like a boutique. And everything's free. We're going to invite the people in this community and the surrounding areas that have a need to come out and enjoy a day of free shopping. And when I say free, free. Everything is available to them. If you know people that are going on job interviews and maybe they need a suit or they need a nice outfit to go on a job interview, have them come in. If you know people that have kids that are going getting ready to go to school and they need a new coat, have them come in. It's just a wonderful way that we can outreach through our community and show the love of Jesus. And of course, we've got some new things coming up in Forge and our Sunday morning ministry. We've got some new programs starting in those. So I'm just excited about everything that's going on. Now today we're going to be talking about something that I believe we all need to hear, because what we're talking about, Scripture tells us that if we would get this right, we would be perfect. Now, I know most of you, and I know myself, and no disrespect intended, but I none of us are perfect, okay? And the interesting thing about this piece of Scripture is most people believe it was written by the brother of Jesus. So if there's anybody that would know about Jesus and his principles, it would be his brother, right? And as one pastor reminds us, if for no other reason to believe in Jesus, you should believe in Jesus because of his brother. It's his half-brother. That, you know, God was his father, and Joseph was James's father. But if for no other reason, you should believe in Jesus because of James. Because think about this. What would it take, if you have a brother, what would it take for your brother to convince you that he was God? If you have a cousin, if you don't have a brother, maybe a cousin or your best friend, what would it take for you to be convinced that they were God? I mean, I look at my brother, and I look at my family, and I look at my friends, and I'm thinking, you know what? It'd be easier to believe they were the son of Satan than the son of God sometimes. So for no other reason, maybe we can believe in Jesus because of his brother James. Because his brother James, just like I, and like people all around the world, believed that he was truly who he said he was. That not only was he the Messiah, the one that was coming to offer salvation, not only was he the Son of God, but that he was God himself. Now, we know that because James starts his letter out like this. This letter is from James, a slave of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I am writing to the 12 tribes, Jewish believers scattered abroad. Greetings. So not only is this letter written by James, who most people believe is the brother of Jesus, half-brother of Jesus, it's written to Christians. So if you're a believer in Christ, this letter is written to you. And if you aren't a believer in Christ, then you sort of get a pass on today's message. Maybe you don't have to apply this to your life like the rest of us do. But my prayer has been that if you haven't quite made your mind up, if Jesus is who he says he is, maybe once you see the truth of this evidence and you see what the scripture speaks about, that you too can believe. Because once you see the truth of scripture, it opens your heart and your mind to the truth of Jesus being exactly who he said he was. Now, I love the book of James. It's one of my favorite books. I have probably spent more time studying the book of James than most other books of the Bible. Because the book of James has been called the How to Handle the Christian Life Manual. It's a book of tests, really. It's what they call a reality check book. James is constantly and consistently telling us to be consistent. He says our actions and our words should match what we say we believe. He even goes as far as to say this. He says, don't just listen to the word of God, do what it says. That's in James chapter 1, verse 22. It says, if you're not doing what God's words is telling you to do, you're just fooling yourself. You may say you're a Christian. You may say that you believe in Jesus. You may say that you're a follower of Christ. But if your words don't match your actions, you're just fooling yourself. What James is saying is there's a difference between saying you're a Christian, saying you're a disciple of Christ, and then actually going out and living it. And as we're going to see in a few minutes, it doesn't mean that we never have any sins. There is a big difference between having a lifestyle of sin and an occasion of God's will than in living God's will with an occasion of sin. We all have occasions of sin, but our lifestyle, the direction of our walk, should be towards God and not towards the world. And what concerns me, what worries me, what bothers me the most are the number of people who think they're safe. And then when you look at them on Monday through Saturday, you couldn't tell that they ever claimed to be a Christian. If you look at their lifestyle and hear their words, they're sheep. And unfortunately, in today's world, it's easier to check up on people. So in today's world, it bothers me even greater because I see in churches and people that I talk to who claim to go to church every single Sunday, and then I see their Facebook account, and what they say to me and what they say on Facebook is not consistent. So James is reminding us, we just can't come to church on Sundays and hear the Word of God and then leave the church and live any kind of way we want. We have to live it every day, not just one day a week. Now, if you ever want to know where you're at in your relationship with God, James is a good book to study. Because James gives us all these different tests. And then he really looks at you and he says, hey, you say you're a Christian? You say you believe? Well, let's test it. Let's see. And James gives us these tests, and they're hard tests. To be honest with you, most of these tests, we're going to fail most of the time. James says, okay, the first test I'm going to give you is the trials and tribulation test. When you get into trials and tribulations, you say that you trust Jesus, but how do you act? He gives us a social relationships test. He says, you trust in Jesus and you say that you're a disciple and that you can be told by your disciple by your love. Well, how do you treat a person of a different race? How do you treat a person or treat a person who's in a different economic situation than you are? How do you treat a person who has more power than you? Do you give them more and show them more attention than you do the person who's poor? James says, you say you're a Christian? Well, let's test it and let's see. But if there's no works, are you really saved? He gives us all the tests. The one that I fail most often is the patient test. And not like being at the doctor. You say you're a Christian? Well, how patient are you? Not very, Lord. I need you to work on your heart a little bit more, Rob. The test we're looking at today specifically is the tongue test. I don't know about you, but this is a test I think we all need to take. And this is a test that I know in myself I fail on. So James comes to us and he says, you say you believe as you should, but are you saying things that you shouldn't? If you say you believe as you do, why are you talking like you don't? Is your speech inconsistent with what you claim you are? So let's start out this morning by asking a question. Has anybody in here ever got in trouble for something they said? 100%. I was getting ready to say, we can ask it another way and say, is there anybody in here that has never gotten in trouble for anything that they've ever said? But I already know the answer to that. Because it's easy to say, I'm trusting in Jesus, and then we have this outpouring of stuff that isn't Christ-like at all. So if you have your Bibles this morning, we're going to be looking at James chapter 3. And James is found near the back of the Bible. James is right after the book of Hebrews. I'm going to be reading, as I do most Sundays, from the New Living Translation. And if you don't have a Bible, don't worry about it. There's some right here by the door. If you don't have one, grab one on the way out. If you like the translation we're reading from today, please grab one, and you can bring it back next week, and you're allowed to write in it, and make notes, and all that kind of stuff. Or even if you know somebody you'd like to give a Bible to, take one. They're free. One of our missions here is to get the Word of God in as many hands as we possibly can. And James is a wonderful book. It can be a very convicting book, because as we look at the book of James, we see what it really takes, and we see how often we fail. George Myers says, we have 7 openings in our head. We have 2 nostrils, 2 ears, 2 eyes, but we only have 1 mouth. And then she asks the question, imagine how much trouble we'd get in if we had 2 mouths. I'm with her. See, what happens is, what we say today, we begin to live tomorrow. Our words today can bring our lifestyle tomorrow. Every word we speak, every single word we speak has power. And that power can either affect us or someone else very negatively or very positively. And Jesus himself gives us very strong warnings in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 12. Jesus said, I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you will be condemned. Words have power. Words determine the course and direction and ultimately the destination of our lives. So in chapter 3 of his letter, the half-brother of Jesus tells us, if Jesus is the Lord of your life, he should also be the Lord of your mouth. The Apostle Paul tells us, even though we're new creatures in Christ, we still carry around this old nature of the flesh. And one of the old natures of the flesh that we carry around, and it's the hardest to tame, is our tongue, is our mouth. The psalmist, King David, says, set a guard over my mouth, O Lord. Keep watch over it. Keep a door over my lips. Jesus says, out of the overflow of our heart, the mouth speaks. So if we want Jesus to be controlling our tongue, we must let Jesus control our heart. The tongue reveals what's actually in our hearts. So if you want to control your tongue, you have to let Jesus control your heart. A doctor says, stick out your tongue and let me see what's wrong with you physically. James says, let me see your tongue and I'll tell you what's wrong with you spiritually. Now, if you're like me, and I know most of you are because I talk to you, Lord forgive me, I know how often we fail the tongue test. I fail it, and I fail it often. My mouth is the one thing that gets me in trouble more than anything else. So I find comfort in these first verse, the second verse of James chapter 3, because it says, indeed, we all make many mistakes. For if we could control our tongues, we would be perfect and could also control ourselves in every other way. Everything that comes out of our mouth is what affects our life. Everything that comes out of our mouth is what controls and gives power to the way we live. If we could control tongue, he actually brings it around. He said, if we could control our tongue, we would be perfect. There would be no sin in us. Because if we could control our tongues, we could control ourselves in every other way. But since we're not perfect, and we know we're not perfect, then in order to control our tongue, we have to let the one who is perfect control our heart so that he can control our tongue. In order to control our tongue, not only do we have to realize the magnitude, James is telling us the magnitude of the problem, he also says this. He says, we can make a large horse go wherever we want by the means of a small bit. Then he says, a small rudder can make a huge ship turn wherever the pilot chooses to go, even though the winds are strong. See what James says, not only is there a magnitude of problem here, not only is the magnitude is that you can't tame your tongue, he also says there is much power in your tongue. In fact, the tongue is out of proportion to its size. A 1,500-pound horse can be controlled by a 1-pound bit. It can either be chose to change directions, it can be brought to a complete stop. That little teeny bit controls the direction of a great big horse. The bit controls the direction of the entire animal. A huge ocean liner, is controlled by a small rudder. The slightest change in the direction of that small rudder changes the course of that great, big, huge ship. The small rudder steers the ship either to its destination or it steers it off course. Your tongue is the same way. It'll either take you where you want to be or it'll take you completely away from where you want to be. This small piece of metal on a ship controls the destination of this massive ship. And it's the same way with our tongues. I had an opportunity several years ago, I think it was about 1996, to go down the Grand Canyon whitewater rafting. And it was an amazing trip. Grand Canyon is the largest navigational water in the world. Anything any larger and more powerful, you can't navigate through. In fact, it's so large and so powerful, it has its own rating system. So we're on the last day of the trip. It's a 14-day trip. We've been going down, and you go, the first real fall they take over there is called a housetop. It's only rated a 3, and they call it housetop because it's the equivalent of taking a ship and pushing it off the top of a house. That's a 3. A 10 is one where you go straight down about 100 yards, and then straight back up, and then back down 80 yards, and then about 70 yards. Amazing trip. Sometimes the water's so rough it's going in different directions. It's just wonderful. But we're on the last day, and we just went over a rapid, and all of a sudden we hear a loud clunk, and our guy's name is Dustin. And all of a sudden, Dustin jumps into action, and you look, and you almost see fear in his face. Now, when your guy starts to become a little scared, it's not a pleasant thing. You could look at his face, you could see the intensity. And what had happened was we hit a rock and it had broken the engine off, which is back here where he stands with that rudder that controls the whole ship. And it had broken off. And all of a sudden he's running around this raft like some man that's gone crazy. And in the distance, we could hear what sounds like a locomotive. Now, we've been down on the raft for about 14 days now, so we knew what that meant. That was a sound that brought a little bit of excitement. and a little bit of fear at the same time, because that meant a large rapid was coming up. And as you get closer, it gets louder, and it gets louder, and we could hear it getting louder. And here's Dustin, he has absolutely no control over the boat. So he flips up, this is what he called the guillotine here. There's a silver box here, there's a silver box here, and he called it the guillotine because he said, when you go over these rapids, it's a rubber raft, they bend together, and if your feet or your hands in here, it'll cut them off. But it's also what they call the chicken coop, because the chicken coop is where the chicken sat. The water is controlled by a dam, so it's really, really cold. In fact, they tell you if you fall off that raft, you have about 20 minutes before you lose consciousness and die. So the chicken sat up here. Let me show you where I sat. That's me. I was right dead front of the center. And I was braver 20 years ago than I am today. But anyway, what Dustin does, he pulls out another engine out of here. He's hastily putting it on. And all of a sudden, you see as the rapids just get closer and closer, he's pulling on the engine, he's pulling, and suddenly it starts up, and he has control over the boat again. Because the only way to go over these large rapids is to be able to go over control. If you don't go over control, you're at the wrath of the river. It'll take you wherever it wants to take you, however it wants to take you, and your hopes of going over it without some kind of control, some kind of rudder, is nearly impossible. See, that's what James is telling us about our tongue. James is saying, listen, if you don't control your tongue, your life is just going to be uncontrollable. You're going to end up someplace you really don't want. You're going to end up in places and going through dangers that you can't control. You got to learn how to control your tongue. Well, you can't control your life. You're going to go off course. You're going to go in a different direction. And ultimately, the destination of your life won't be where it is. He says, it's the same way. The tongue is a small thing that makes grand speeches. James wants us to realize the size of the tongue is disproportionate to the power. And James begins to illustrate this. And what he does is he gives us illustrations of the horse, and he gives us an illustration of the ship, but they're both neutral. You can take a ship in either direction that you do by controlling the rudder. You can take the horse in either direction by controlling the bit. But James wants to know the potential danger of the tongue. So now he begins to list examples that show us the danger of the tongue. He says a tiny spark can set a great forest on fire. And again, James begins, he's a great communicator, like his half-brother. He begins to give us word pictures so we can sort of picture in the mind. He says, among these, all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It is a whole world of wickedness, corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for it is set on fire by hell itself. See what he's saying? Among all the parts of your body, tongue can be the most dangerous. It's a flame of fire. It's a whole world of wickedness. And it doesn't just corrupt itself like most things does. It corrupts the entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for the tongue is set on fire by hell itself. See, James makes reference to this through his book. He says, since all evil comes from the devil, we can't control our tongue in our own power. I mean, he already told us, if we could control our tongues, we'd be perfect. And unless we're delusional, we know we aren't perfect. James says the tongue is a whole world of wickedness. It corrupts the whole body. It's on fire. It sets the course of our lives. It's set on fire by hell itself. Now, the word he uses for hell here is the Greek word Gehenna. And Gehenna is only used a couple times in the scriptures. And the only time the word Gehenna is used is by Jesus himself and here by James. Now, what that was, I mean, the people he was talking to would have known immediately what that was. Gehenna referred to a place in the Hinnom Valley which ran along the south side of Jerusalem. And it's where they would literally stack dead animals. In that point of time in the past, there had been human sacrifices, and they dumped those in there, and they dumped all their garbage on there, and it had been set on fire, and because of the garbage and the animal remains and the human remains, it was a constant burning fire. It never went out, and it had a horrible stench to it. In fact, it was so awful, it began to be known as a place of judgment and sorrow. So James is saying something like, you know that stinking, smoldering trash dump with human bodies and dead animals and all your trash in it? He says, that's how your tongue is. When you don't let Jesus control your heart, the garbage in your heart becomes on fire. Our tongues let everybody see the wickedness that's in our hearts. You know, you take this small spark, you take a glowing ember, you take a smoldering ash, you're going to start a great big forest fire. You know, how many times have you heard in the news where these raging fires, most of them are out in California, but you hear these great fires that burn thousands and thousands of acres. And they trace it back to a careless cigarette butt thrown out the window or a careless camper. What he's saying is even those things that are spoken accidentally, with no ill intent, all of that can cause great damage. I mean, you think about this and think about your own life and your own life experiences. More friendships, more marriages end, more families divided, more churches are split by an unguarded word than by anything else. Our tongues have the power to give life or give death. Our tongues have the power to do great damage. Words can hurt and words can heal. You have to look at yourself and say, what have my words done today? Then James begins to back what he said. He starts to give us evidence. And he gives us evidence from human experience, and he gives us evidence in nature. He says, people can tame all kinds of animals, birds, reptiles, and fish, but no one, and we have to be careful here, no one, meaning no man, no woman, can tame the tongue. See, we've learned in our human experience, we can train all kinds of animals. We see them on TV, we see them at the zoo, we especially see them in movies in today's time. We can train them in just about any kind of way we want. James is saying mankind can train every animal, but he can't train his tongue. And again, we have to be careful with it. It doesn't say the tongue can't be tamed. It just says we can't tame our tongue. We have to submit our tongue to the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, if you think about this, as you're training these animals, there's two ways that you can get an animal to submit to you, isn't there? There's two ways you can get an animal to come and do the things you want. And when does that animal submit? When it's learned who its master is. And you can beat an animal into submission, but have you ever seen an animal that's been beaten? It just cowers. A dog will stick its tail between its legs. It's afraid. Or you can love an animal into submission. And have you ever seen an animal that's been loved into submission? That animal is loyal to its master. That animal gets excited when their master comes home. That's the way Jesus Christ is. He wants us to come to him with love. He wants us to come to him and be trained by him with love. He doesn't want to beat us into submission. He wants to love us into submission. He says most animals can be trained by man, but in his own power, man can't tame his own tongue. So when we submit to our master, he'll tame it for us. Only God can tame the tongue of man. And James goes on and says it's restless and evil and it's full of a deadly poison. See, it's like we have this cyanide capsule that's hidden behind our teeth. It's ready to break open. And it's going to spread death wherever it goes. It can spread death to us. It can spread death to others. But not only, here's the thing, not only is our tongue evil and full of deadly poison, it's restless. It's not like the snake who's waiting to strike out if it's attacked. The tongue is on the hunt. The tongue is looking for something to attack. See, the tongue is looking for something. It's restless. So in order for us to control our tongues, the first thing we've got to see is the magnitude of the problem we face. The second thing we have to realize is how powerful the tongue is. And then James says, in order to tame the tongue, we have to realize that in human strength, it's untamable. You simply can't do it. In order for us to control our tongues, we have to let Jesus control our hearts and our thoughts, because out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And then finally, James says we have to see the tongue as a freak of nature. He says, sometimes it praises our Lord and Father, and sometimes it curses those who have been made in the very image of our Lord and Father. And so blessings and curses come out and are pouring out of the same mouth. And surely, my brothers and sisters, this is not right. Does a spring of water bubble out with both fresh water and bitter water? Does a fig tree produce olives and grapevine produce figs? No. And you can't draw fresh water from a salty spring. See, what James is telling us is our tongue is sick. It's a freak. Our tongue is a freak of nature. James says, in one breath, you can be praising to the Lord, and in the very next breath, you can be cursing somebody who is made in the very image of God. I was actually doing a series on the study of James one time, where God, in his ultimate wisdom and his, I will say, sense of humor, gave me a very good illustration of this. I'm going through McDonald's parking lot in Seaford. I don't know if you all know where that's at. And on the phone, this was before cell phone calls, okay? This was a long time ago. I'm talking to a buddy of mine who's going through the Methodist lay speaker camp. And I'm talking to him, and he's having some trouble. So I'm just praising God, and I'm telling him, by the highway, if you don't merge, you hit a bridge. So I'm merging, and there's this lady next to me. If I speed up, she speeds up. It's evident she's not going to let me in. So I gun my car, talking to him and praising God. My mouth changes gears, and I cut in front of her, and then she pulls up beside me, and it's obvious she's very mad. In fact, she's so mad, things are coming out of her mouth, shouldn't come out, and she's pointing at me, but she's so mad, she forgets to point like this. She's using another finger. And I'm telling you, I'm praising God, and all of a sudden, I see her pointing at me, and I start to tell her how she's messing up, and she's using the wrong finger. I was praising God, and the next thing I know, I'm talking to somebody in a way that I shouldn't. It's made in the very image of God. And then my mouth changes gear again, and I'm praising God again. I didn't think anything about it until I went home and started studying for my lessons in James. And guess which lesson I was studying? It should not be. Blessing and cursing come pouring out of the same mouth. Truly, my brothers and sisters, this should not be. We're created in the image of God. Our words, our tongues should bring glory to God. A fountain doesn't produce both fresh water and salt water. If you saw a fig tree producing olives, or if you saw a grapevine producing figs, you'd say that's a freak of nature. It's not consistent with the source. Your tongue is a freak of nature. It produces both praise and cursing, and it shouldn't be that way. Our hearts are filled up with the love of Jesus, then our lips should overflow with this goodness. And here's the big idea. Here's what I think James is telling. Here's the big idea. Don't be hung by your tongue. It is so easy to do. Don't be hung by your tongue. Your tongue sets the direction and the course and ultimately the destination of your life. Success and failure is conceived in the mind, but it is given birth through our mouth.
Amen.
What you speak is what you get, so don't be hung by your tongue. Victory or defeat, blessings and curses, good or evil, are all conceived in the mind and given birth by our words. Proverbs 23:7 says in the King James Version, "For as he thinketh a man in his heart, so is he. As you think, so are you." And Jesus says, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. What we speak is what we get, so don't be hung by your tongue. James asked the question. He said, is your faith real? You say it is? Let's test that. Does Jesus control your heart? Because if he does, you'll control your tongue. But honestly, and you that know me, you know this. I failed this so many times. And I know most of you have as well. So how do we control our tongue? I mean, James starts out by telling us if we could control our tongues, we'd be perfect, and we could also control ourselves in every other way. And James sort of ends this up and wraps up this section of his letter by backing it up with some examples from human experience and from nature. He says, no one can tame the tongue. It's restless. It's full of evil. It's full of a deadly poison. So if that's the case, how can we control our tongue? Well, I think this is the answer, and James alludes to this. And if you haven't never taken the time, or you've been a long time since you read the book of James, I would encourage you to do so. It's a very short book. It's only 5 chapters. In the New International Version, it only has 108 verses, so it's fast. but it will really tell you how to live this Christian life. But he says, in order to pass the tongue test, the first thing you've got to realize is the magnitude of your problem. He said, the impossibility of you doing it on your own. Second, you have to recognize the power of the tongue, both for good and evil. The tongue defiles, it defies, and it displays what we truly are in our heart. And third, you just have to understand there's only one person who can tame your tongue, that you have to let the one perfect person, Jesus Christ, control your tongue. And finally, he says, you have to realize your tongue is a freak of nature. It's able to give both praises and curses at the same time. I can control my tongue by allowing Jesus to control my heart. At any moment in time, that my tongue isn't controlled, at that moment in time, I'm not controlled by Jesus. I can control my tongue by allowing God to control my heart. But how do we do that? I mean, if it's impossible for man or woman to tame their own tongue, James tells us if our faith is real and we believe as we should, then we should talk as we should. So how do we pass the tongue test? And how, in other words, how do we not get hung by our tongue? The first thing is, you've got to know that you can't tame your own tongue. It's impossible. So you have to go to the Lord and ask Him to tame it for you. You have to begin with prayer. James tells us in his first chapter of his book, chapter 1, if you need wisdom, ask our generous God and He will give it to you. He will not rebuke you for asking, but when you ask Him, be sure your faith is in God alone. Taming the tongue starts with going to God and asking Him to do it for you, but you have to go by faith and believe He can do it, and you can't. You have to have faith that God will take care of it, and you don't have to do the work because He will. The second step is to surrender to God's will. You begin to pray, and as you pray, He opens your heart. Surrender to God's will and let go of your will. His will for your life is always better than your will for your life. But as long as you keep on doing whatever it is that you want to do, and you keep on disobeying what God wants you to do, your words will contradict what you came to believe, and what you claim to believe, and the direction and the course, and ultimately the destination of your life will be farther and farther away from God instead of closer and closer to God. So we pray, we surrender to God's will, because He can quench the fires of hell. He can tame the snarling beast. He can give you the antidote to the poison. He can tame that wild beast. And then finally, we simply repent. It doesn't mean we just stop doing what we're doing. We pray to God. We ask Him to surrender His will. And then we change our way of thinking, so we change our way of acting. We start to have thoughts that go along with God's thoughts and not our thoughts, because out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. In order to control our tongues, we have to let Jesus control our hearts. When we let Jesus control our hearts, we'll see the magnitude of the problem that we have, the magnitude of the problem we face, and then we'll recognize how powerful the tongue is. And James says and tells us that the tongue is a freak of nature. It has more strength than you can handle in your human strength. You need the Holy Spirit strength to tame the tongue. The tongue test. James says, is your faith real? Well, let's see if it is. If you say as you believe, why do you act like you don't believe? If you say you believe as you should, why do you say things that you shouldn't? If you say you believe as you do, why are you talking the way you are? Is your speech inconsistent with what you proclaim you are? Tame that untamable beast. Let God do what you can't do. Ask God to tame your tongue by going to Him in prayer, by surrendering your will to His will, and by repenting of your sinful speech. Change your stinking thinking so you change your stinking talking. Here's a poem I came across a couple years ago, and of course I'm going to let you know if I modified it. And we'll close with this. The boneless tongue, so small and weak, can crush and kill, declares the Greek. The tongue dishoards a greater horde, the Turk asserts, than does the sword. A Persian proverb wisely saith, a lengthy tongue, an early death. Or as the Welsh say instead, don't let your tongue cut off your head. The tongue can speak a word whose speed, the Chinese says, outstrips the steed. While Arab sages this impart, the tongue's great storehouse is the heart. From Hebrew writ this maxim's from, through feet should slip, never let the tongue. The sacred writer crowns the whole, who keeps his tongue, doth keep his soul. And here at the Odyssey Church, we just simply say, don't get hung by your tongue or your life will become unstrung. Let's ask God this morning to change our hearts so God can change our tongue. For out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this lesson from the brother of Jesus, Lord, the one that came to believe that he was truly the risen Messiah, that he was truly your son, that he was truly God in the flesh. And if the brother of James or the brother of Jesus can believe that Jesus was God, shouldn't we? Father, help us keep our tongue between. Please help us keep our tongue behind that enamel gate that you've given us. Wise man once said that we'll have many opportunities to keep our mouth shut. We should take advantage of them all. Father, help us to speak good and not evil, to speak blessings and not cursing. Help us, Lord, to choose our words wisely so that the course and the direction and ultimately the destination of our lives are exactly where you want to be. Father, we praise you this morning for all that we have seen and heard. Amen. All right. Don't forget to come back next week, and I would ask you to please use your tongues for good over the next week by inviting several people to come with you as we have our barbecue and we have our fellowship. Take those postcards out and invest in light. Begin to pray for your lost loved ones and invite them to come back to church with you next week so that some may be found and saved. And if you'd like to take communion or you'd like to know a little bit more about communion, or if you have a special prayer request, please see me. I'll be in the prayer room, which is a door right to the right as you leave. And if you have a prayer request or you want to know a little bit more out of the Odyssey Church, look for some of those people with those name badges and just ask them. May the Lord, the blessings of God, the blessings of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be among you and with you wherever you find yourself this week. Come back next week and bring an appetite. God bless you. See you then.